One of the things I have to say, though, that I always try to make clear to people is, one, there's no data that it stops disease. So that's the one thing. It's never shown that it cures Parkinson's. And two, I also want to make sure that we inform patients that it's not a replacement for dopamine. And the reason that's important is because we also had some experience with individuals who were frightened of dopamine. And I know there's a lot of literature out there that can be very frightening for people. But the idea that they weren't taking dopamine all they wanted to do was exercise. And what we noticed is that those people really struggled. I mean, they really were not able to get the most out of practice. They have got a lot of fatigability when they tried to exercise. And so the point was they didn't really get the benefits of exercise because they couldn't do it, right? And so the other part of the equation is there's a reason for dopamine, right? And so dopamine has a role for synaptic plasticity. Obviously, practice is important, but dopamine enables.
Can you talk a little bit about, so there's the standard of care treatment right now is levodopa, carbidopa, right?
And right, so dopamine replacement, because Parkinson's disease, as I said, causes obviously dopamine depletion with circuit changes, but the dopamine depletion is also what's driving some of this loss, these loss of connections. We need dopamine back because dopamine is what enables synapses to form as well, along with practice, and it also alleviates the symptoms themselves. So treating with L-DOPA will help a lot of the symptoms of slowness and stiffness that will allow you to get the most out of practice. Oh. I can move better. I can move more accurate when I can, you know, I'm not feeling slow or stiff. So, you know, again, I think of the L-DOPA, which is what we give, carbidopa, levodopa.
L-DOPA gets converted into dopamine.
L-DOPA, yeah. So L-DOPA is a prodrug that I ingest with carbidopa. Carbidopa blocks the peripheral metabolism of L-DOPA, so it doesn't break down in the blood or make me sick.
So carbidopa prevents L-DOPA from becoming dopamine before it gets into the brain.
Right.
Is that right?
That's correct. Okay. Uh-huh. And then... But the idea there is once L-DOPA makes it into the brain, it gets converted in the brain in those remaining cells to dopamine. And that is now targeting those circuits that I mentioned, the automatic circuits, right? And that's what allowing it to work more efficiently. And then the idea is with adding exercise, it may also drive repair.
Right. So you're saying that exercise is not a replacement for the L-DOPA,
right.
Carbidopa. But it's in combination, you know,
right.
Because you obviously still need the dopamine. And I think that the L-DOPA and the carbidopa itself doesn't actually slow disease progression, but it does help treat symptoms. But that's,
yeah.
After a certain time, doesn't some of those become refractory?
I would say there are several points. One is that, because those cells are not storing it as well, they're, you know, you're having to dose more frequently, so that's a cell dysfunction problem. Mm-hmm. And then secondarily, there are other circuits, cognitive circuits as an example, that are getting affected. And we know cognition plays a big role in my ability to move safely through space. And so that's going to be a big contributor. And L-DOPA does not do as much. It's not as effective for cognitive function. It has a role there, but it's one of many different chemicals, acetylcholine being another one, serotonin, norepinephrine being other ones.
These things are also modulated by exercise, and there have been meta-analyses that have been done looking at various types of exercise and their effect on cognitive function, executive function, global cognitive function, memory. And those things can be improved
by particularly the aging, an aging field, I'd say, is a little further ahead of us in terms of their data. It's probably the strongest data is in the aging field right now.
Absolutely,
right,
it is. But there are some with Parkinson's patients that they have looked at, and so it certainly is affecting cognition as well.